Norway is building the world's first full-scale ship tunnel, and it's not just for convenience. This is about saving lives. For centuries, sailors have battled across the brutal Stadhavet Sea, one of the most dangerous waters along Norway's coast. Treacherous winds, massive waves, and deadly storms have sent countless ships to the bottom. Now, after more than 100 years of debate, construction has finally begun on a solution: a 1.7 kilometer tunnel carved through solid rock, offering a safe passage for up to 120 ships per day. But why did it take so long to get started? And how will this bold engineering project actually work? Let's take a look. Before we sail through the details of Norway's ship tunnel, make sure to anchor down and subscribe for the latest on groundbreaking architecture and mega projects. So now, you already know the idea of cutting a tunnel through Norway's Stad Peninsula is not new. The first real proposal appeared in 1874, back when Norway was still figuring out its modern infrastructure. That's how long sailors have been dealing with the brutal Stadhavet Sea. And they were not just complaining for no reason. The Stadhavet is one of the most dangerous stretches of sea along Norway's coast. Some waves here can reach up to 30 meters high, which is like a 10-story building crashing down on your boat. People have died here, at least 33 since World War II. Many more have had close calls, with ships damaged, cargo lost, and crews stranded. Even in the old days, Viking sailors were so afraid of these waters that instead of risking the crossing, they dragged their ships overland to avoid the worst of it. If that doesn't prove that this place is a problem, what does? So, if the danger has been this obvious for centuries, why hasn't anyone built the tunnel before now? The short answer is money, politics, and skepticism. There were multiple attempts to push for a ship tunnel in the 1900s, but it always came down to cost. Digging a 1.7 kilometer tunnel through solid rock is not cheap. Reports from different time periods kept debating whether it was worth it. Some experts argued that modern ships could handle the waves better, so maybe the tunnel was not necessary. Others worried that traffic would not be high enough to justify the expense. In 2011, an economic study shot the idea down, saying it was not profitable enough. That nearly killed the project. But by 2013, Norway's National Transport Plan revived it. This plan recognised that it is time to think beyond just the expense of the project and care more about safety, efficiency, and the future of sea transport. The past few decades have made the need for the tunnel even more obvious. Today, Norway's seafood industry is at its top, with exports reaching over $13 billion annually, and continuing to grow. In fact, Norway is the world's second largest seafood exporter. It supplies fresh fish to over 150 countries. But that success comes with a major problem. Thousands of vessels carrying seafood are forced to navigate the dangerous Stadhavet Sea every year. Many of these vessels end up stuck for hours, or even days, waiting for safer conditions. When ships cannot sail, deliveries are delayed, seafood spoils, and businesses lose money. Take Mowi, for example. This company is the world's largest producer of farmed salmon, so these delays prove to be a serious financial hit for companies like this. Their transport vessels regularly cross Stad, and when bad weather forces them to wait, their fish lose value by the hour. Industry reports estimate that up to 20% of seafood transport in this region is delayed due to rough seas. That's not just an inconvenience. They're losing millions of dollars in lost revenue every year. The concerning part is that it's not just seafood. The shipping and tourism industries also suffer. The Stad region handles over 100 cargo ships per week, and many face route disruptions. Cruise lines that want to offer scenic coastal routes must either risk rough waters or cancel sailings altogether. The tunnel would provide a safe and predictable passage for up to 120 ships per day. It will reduce delays and improve reliability across multiple industries. Then there is climate change. Extreme weather events are on the rise, and Stadhavet is already one of the stormiest parts of Norway's coastline, with wind speeds often exceeding 30 metres per second. Forecasts predict that storms and high waves will increase in both frequency and intensity in the coming decades. More bad weather means even more delays, more damage, and higher risks for ships and crew. At some point, the question is not, should we build this tunnel? It is, why haven't we already? Think about this. If the Stad ship tunnel had been built decades ago, how many lives would have been spared? How much money wouldn't have been lost? How many ships wouldn't have been damaged or wrecked? But now, finally, it is happening. So what's the plan for this one-of-its-kind project? After decades of debate, feasibility studies and delays, the Norwegian government has fully approved the project. Construction is expected to start in late 2025 and finish by 2030. So, what exactly are they building? The Stad ship tunnel will be the world's first full-scale ship tunnel, which will cut 1.7 kilometres through solid rock at the narrowest point of the Stad Peninsula. The tunnel will be 36 metres wide and 49 metres high. This height means the tunnel will be large enough to accommodate most cargo ships, ferries, and even some cruise vessels. Around 3 million cubic metres of rock will be excavated to create this passage. To keep things organised, the Norwegian Coastal Administration will control traffic flow, similar to how air traffic control manages planes. Ships will be given time slots to pass through safely, avoiding congestion and making the whole process smooth and efficient. The tunnel is designed to handle 70 to 120 ships per day. This will improve the safety and reliability of maritime transport on a huge level. Now the question is, how will it be built? This is not like digging a simple road tunnel. Because the tunnel will cut through solid, nice rock, construction will use the drill and blast method. It is the same technique used in Norway's massive road and railway tunnels. You see, in the drill and blast method, rocks are drilled to a certain depth, then explosives are placed in the pit, and the sections are carefully blasted away while reinforcing the walls. This makes stability while minimizing environmental impact. Now, what if water comes in when a certain section is blasted? Well, to prevent flooding during excavation, the entrances will be sealed off with temporary cofferdams. This will allow workers to carve out the tunnel without seawater rushing in. The construction will happen from both ends simultaneously, speeding up the process. Once complete, the tunnel will operate year-round, providing a safe, all-weather passage for vessels that currently have to gamble with the unpredictable Stadhavet Sea. Given how difficult its construction is going to be, the next question is, how much is it going to cost and who is paying? Right now, the total budget is estimated at 3.45 billion Norwegian kron, which is about $400 million. However, unlike many major infrastructure projects, the tunnel will not be funded through tolls or user fees. It will be free for ships to use. The Norwegian government is covering the cost as part of its national transport plan, because it has recognised it as an investment in both safety and economic growth. But it does not mean this project is smooth sailing. No way. Blasting through rock and keeping the tunnel dry are big challenges. Sure, but not the only ones. One major issue is making sure the environment is not harmed in the process. Digging out 3 million cubic metres of rock means the construction crew will end up disrupting the local ecosystem, and Norway takes its nature very seriously. Any mistake, like improper disposal of excavated material, could damage marine life. Then there is traffic management. The tunnel is not a free-for-all. Ships will need scheduled slots to pass through safely. But what happens if there's a backlog? What if a ship gets stuck? Keeping things smooth and efficient will take careful planning. Right now, 6 major contractors are competing for the job. Norway is choosing carefully because whoever wins this sets the standard for future projects. We can only hope they pick the best so that the Statship tunnel becomes less of a headache to build and operate. Regardless of who is chosen, what can you expect once it's done? The tunnel is built for one-way traffic, which means it will alternate direction every hour. There will be no awkward ship standoffs in the middle. And before anyone asks, no, it won't be two-way. That would mean building a second tunnel, and that's not happening anytime soon. As for size, it is designed for ships up to 16,000 tons, so expect ferries, cargo vessels, and maybe even smaller cruise ships using it regularly. Speed-wise, the limit inside the tunnel will likely be 8 knots, meaning a ship will take roughly 10 minutes to pass through. All of these factors come together to create a carefully managed and efficient system, one that's set to dramatically improve both safety and logistics for Norway's maritime operations. After over a century of debate, Norway is finally making the Statship tunnel a reality. This 1.7-kilometre passage will cut through solid rock to provide a safe, all-weather route for up to 120 ships a day, protecting sailors from the brutal Statshavet Sea. Beyond safety, it's a game-changer for Norway's seafood industry, shipping routes, and even tourism. With construction set to begin soon, this ambitious project could redefine maritime transportation for generations to come. But what do you think? Should more countries build ship tunnels like this? Or is this just a one-of-a-kind solution for Norway? Let me know your thoughts in the comments. And if you're interested in more groundbreaking architecture, engineering, and mega projects, be sure to subscribe to DesignZip for more videos like this. Thanks for watching, and see you in the next one.